You are now listening to Straight Talk, No Chaser with Hadassah.
Welcome, welcome to the second episode of my podcast, Straight Talk, No Chaser. And I'd like to say a special welcome to my loyal listeners and to the 12 tribes scattered abroad. Welcome to the Israel Gang tribe. Thank you so much for joining in today. I'd like to give shout out at this time. And my first shout out goes to Walk Through Scriptures with the Douglas Twins on the Negro Only Nation YouTube channel at 2 p.m. on Sundays, Central Daylight Time. The second shout out goes to Tobiel Ben Israel class, which takes place on the Sabbath at 10 a.m. Central Daylight Time. And you can DM Tyler Holmes, who is the host, on Messenger, and he will send you a link to join the class.
To love that granny drug does dope for a parent to never walk out of their child's life. This love is real, it's more than knowing that you're an Israelite. It'll be dope to leave your door unlocked, not worry about home invaded gym. Daughters will never prostitute if you ain't teach your sons to pimp. Pimp pants is more drug dealer than a deep boy. Fish steady dope with a lot of cut. Decoy, lack of knowledge, deep story. How your daddy make you a crack, baby? You sold drugs to your mama, boy. You falsifying self-love when abusing your rig. Don't love yourself, then you can't love nobody
ooh,
else, Steve.
Ooh, make your body a temple. Cinnamon club, yeah. Ooh, it'll be dope to love.
It'll be dope.
Make your body a temple.
If we let go of jealousy, it will be dope if we let go of envy. It will be dope if we let go of poverty. It will be dope if we let go of hard to see. It will be dope if we show love to the poor. It will be dope if we lived on one accord. It will be dope if my people kept commandments. It's always dope because the Most High's in control. It will be dope when He sends us back. It would be dope if you could just believe. It would be dope if you just can see. You're sure with them angels be that justice league.
Ooh, it'd be dope to love. Ooh, make your body a temple. Cinnamon club, yeah. Ooh, it'd be dope to love. Make your body a temple. Cinnamon club, yeah.
It'll be dope to love. Be with your surgery instead of plastic. Gotta keep this love fresh, just zip some rings, wrap it, bag it, strips is it moving from state to state. Let's get it to Blonde Saint with the rock of salvation. Get paid in heaven. Where the daughters of Zion, they won't set it by their foot. $40,000 tour, anybody at the club, huh? If we don't not to participate, then the genocide of your race can help to shape that weight. Refuse to lead like I don't regret.
Ooh, make your body a temper. Sit in a crowd, yeah.
You are now listening to Straight Talk, No Chaser with Hadassah.
So today I have a very special guest, and I'd like to introduce him at this point of time. So he's one of the founders of the Negro-only congregation. He's a husband to a beautiful Trini wife, and he's very knowledgeable in the scriptures. And most of all, he's a brother and a dear friend to me. So, my listening audience and Israel, I'd like us to give a warm welcome to Yahneqotha Douglas.
Hello.
Welcome to Straight Talk No Chaser. It's a pleasure having you here.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here, sis. I sure do appreciate you calling and asking me to jump on. I wouldn't have missed it for nothing in the world.
Thank you so much. So, Yahneqotha, tell us a little about Negroes Only Congregation. Just a brief description of who you are, so the listening audience could understand what you are about as a team, as a congregation, Negroes Only.
The brothers over there, brothers and sisters, the whole congregation over there at Negroes Only, we try to create an atmosphere where brothers and sisters can come together and not have to worry about the pressures of, you know, being in a camp or nothing like that. We're just a congregation of like-minded individuals, like-minded brews. Nobody's above another, and we're all there to learn from each other and from the Ruach. So, and we all stand on the agreement that the 12 tribes of Israel are Negro. Shout out to my brothers, Big Country. Shout out to Uriah. Shout out to Yosef and Douglas, my twin, and all the other brothers and sisters that have been helping us put this together since day one. Imar, also you, Hadassah. Yeah, you part of the congregation as well.
Yes. And I must say to my listening audience, I have learned so much. You all know my story about coming into the truth in 2019. And I've always prayed for other fellow believers that I could associate myself with. And the Most High had brought me to Negroes Only. And during the couple of months that I've met this congregation, I have learned so much. My knowledge and understanding in the truth has deepened, and I've, you know, it has caused me to get closer to the Most High. So meeting the Negroes Only crew or congregation, I have been blessed in a tremendous way, and I'm thankful and I'm grateful to the Most High for this.
Hallelujah.
So Yahneqotha, let's jump right into it. Did the Messiah died for the entire world? So, you know, most of us have come out of Christianity and we have been indoctrinated by Christianity. So This is a topic that is a staple in our community, and we hear so many versions and so many ideologies about it. But today on Straight Talk No Chaser, we're going to tackle this once and for all. So Yahneqotha, did the Messiah die for the whole world?
No, he did not.
Correct.
Just gonna get, you know, you said no chaser, so no, he did not. That's a doctrine that's been taught in the Roman Catholic Church since its inception. It's called the John 3:16 doctrine, where it says, where it was purposefully misinterpreted and misquoted, where it says, "So Yah so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." Well, the Most High only recognized one nation of people as an everlasting world, so to speak. And that would be the nation of Israel. You know, the Most High Yah himself said it, "Israel is an everlasting world unto me." you know.
Yes.
The rest of the nations be a spittle, drop in the bucket, you know. There's other quotes in the scriptures. And I mean, if you really wanted to get down to the brass tacks of it, you know, what is salvation? Is it, you know, salvation is from your sin, right? Well, who's under the law?
Yes.
You know, you got to ask these questions. And then if your church is telling you, oh, well, you're not, nobody's under the law, you know, if any congregation or camp or whatever, nobody's under the law. Well, that's a lie. The only law that was ever changed was the law of sacrifice. But every other law we are to keep. And the Messiah even said that. Those who say they love me and keep not the law, that man is a liar and the truth is not in him.
And we could look at also, as the scripture says in Matthew 15:24, where the Hamashiach, which was sent to us, had said, I'm not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And it is so fascinating to see that every time you deal with fellow Israelites who do not believe that he only came to the lost sheep of Israel, or for the other nations who believe that he died for everybody because of the indoctrination of Christianity, somehow they seem to jump over that verse. Like that verse seems to be invisible in the scriptures to them. And it's plain to see that it's there in black and white. He said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So how could people misinterpret such a plain verse? There's, as we say, straight up, no chaser. That verse is plain to see. There's no if, buts about that verse.
Mm-hmm. And when you go to Amos chapter 3, verse 1 through 2, has a lot to say. It says, Amos chapter 3, verse 1, hear this word that Yahuwah has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the entire clan which I brought up out of the land of Mitzrayim, saying, you alone have I known of all the clans of the earth. Therefore, I punish you for all your wicked.
That is clear.
That's clear cut right there.
Yep. So it just do understand why people just can't see this. And my whole ideology, I think most of the people who try to say that he died for everyone is one of the indoctrination of Christianity, which has a lot of us messed up. And two, the other nations who realize, who are saying they are cleaving, and they now realize that the truth is out there, that he didn't die for everybody, trying to find some loophole where they could fit in this equation, where they're going to find some door window that they are included amongst the Israelites. But then the scripture say, and I'm paraphrasing, that the Messiah said that he that don't come through the door but come through the window is a robber or a thief.
Absolutely. He that cometh through not the front door but through a window or a side door is a robber and a thief. For behold, I stand at the door and knock. In other words, he's making himself known to you. He's not a thief in the night. He's making himself known. So, and a lot of times when you're dealing with Christianity, they can't explain to you what exactly salvation is, right? Because they're transfixed on the New Testament. But I can go into the New and the Old Testament and show them exactly what salvation for certain people are. Everybody else, I would not call that really salvation, but being spared, if you will. Like Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31 says, see, the days are coming, declares Yahuwah. When the scripture starts off like that, it's letting you know that it is a prophecy that has not happened yet. And this is the Most High speaking. He says, see, the days are coming, declares Yahuwah, when I shall make a new covenant with the house of Yisrael and the house of Yahudah. Not like the covenant I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of Mitzrayim. My covenant, which they broke, though I was a husband to them, declares Yahuwah. For this is the covenant I shall make with the house of Israel after those days, declares Yahuwah. And I shall put my Torah in their inward parts, and write it on their hearts. I'm going to pause right there. What did he say that he was going to do? Put his what? His Torah, his law. And the inward part. So those that are saying the law has been done away with, you're cut right there. The Most High said he's going to put it in our inward parts. Right? He said he's going to put it in our inward parts and write it on our hearts. And I shall be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. He never once mentioned Christianity or Islam.
Correct. And then the scriptures talk about we as Israelites need to put away the gods of wood and stone, and which is Christianity and the Muslim faith.
Mm-hmm.
So when they're talking about salvation, and as we're saying that he did not die for the entire world, and when we think about salvation, and you could correct me if I'm wrong, salvation was basically for the Israelites. And seeing that the Most High made a covenant with us within the wilderness when we were in the Exodus, when we were delivered out of Egypt and were taken into the wilderness, a covenant was made between us and blood was sprinkled upon us as a people. And there were conditions that were made with us. If we kept the covenant, this will be the condition. We're going to be a blessed people and everything going to be good and dandy. But if we break the covenant, there will also some conditions apply. And we know the story. We did not keep our end of the bargain and we broke the covenant. And as a result, many things befall us as a people. And breaking the covenant, it caused a rift between that relationship that we had with the Most High. What I understand as well is during the time where we have sinned bitterly before the Most High, we as a 12 tribes of Israel, our kingdom was rent in two, where we had a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom within the scriptures, if we know our biblical history. And as a result, there was the parting of the kingdom. We know that the Messiah was prophesied to come to redeem Israel back to himself, back unto the Most High. Yeah. And in sending the Messiah, because he redeeming us back unto himself, we are the ones that needed the salvation in the first place, because we are the one that broke this covenant.
Absolutely spot on, sis, because this understanding of why Israel is being saved, why is Israel in we got to understand, we got to break this down. So salvation is for Yisrael because Yisrael is in captivity.
Right.
Right? So other people, other nations who are not Yisrael are not in captivity. What exactly do they need to be saved from? Right?
Right.
So let's go to Psalms 126. Right? And I know a lot of people don't really check out Psalms, but on this topic, it has a lot to say. Psalms 126, it says, a song of degrees. When Yahuwah turns back the captivity of Zion, we shall be like dreamers. Then our mouth shall be filled with laughter, our tongue with singing. Then shall they say amongst the Gentiles, Yahuwah has done greatness for them. Yahuwah shall do greatness for us. We shall be glad. Turn back our captivity, O Yahuwah. Like the streams of the south, those sowing in the tares shall reap with songs of joy. And he who goes on and weeps, bearing seed for sowing, and shall indeed come in with rejoicing, bearing his sheaves. You understand? So, there's time and time and time again in the scripture where it's talking about how the Most High will turn back the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem. Those of us that are, those of the Israelites who had been taken and placed on slave ships, like Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 68 stated. And if we go further and read in Joel, what he talks about, what he's going to do. So if we go to Joel chapter 3, this will put the penny in it. And this is to let everybody know who the Most High, this is the end times, who the Most High is going to save. Okay, and this is, my bad, I thought I was there. Joel chapter 3, starting at verse 1. It says, "For look, in those days and at that time, when I turn back the captivity of Yehudah and Jerusalem, then shall I gather all the Gentiles to bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I shall enter into judgment with them there for my people, my inheritance, Yisrael." This is the Most High saying that Yisrael is his inheritance, "whom they have scattered amongst the Gentiles. They have divided up my lands. They have cast lot for my people, and they have given a young man for a whore and sold a girl for wine and drank it." Verse 4. "Then also, what are you to me, O Sor and Zidon, and all the coast of Palestine? Are you repaying me? And if you are repaying me, I would swiftly and speedily return your reward upon your own head. For you have taken my silver, my gold, and you have brought my treasures into your temples. And my people, Yehudah, and the people of Jerusalem have you sold into the sons of the Grecians to remove them far from their fort." Verse 7. "See, I am stirring them up out of the place which you have sold them, and I shall return on your own head what you have done, and shall sell your sons and your daughters to the hands of the people of Yehudah, and they shall sell them to the Sabians, to a nation far off, for Yahuwah Shabaoth has spoken. Proclaim this amongst the Gentiles, prepare for battle. Wake up the mighty men, and let the men of battle draw near, and let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords, and your pruning hooks into spears, and let the weak say, I am strong. Hasten and come all you Gentiles, and gather together all around. Oh Yahuwah, let your mighty men come down here. Let the Gentiles be aroused and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat. For there I shall sit to judge all the Gentiles on every side." Verse 13, "To put in the sickle, for the harvest has grown ripe. Come down, for the winepress is filled. The vats overflow, for the evil is great. Crowds in the valley of decision, for the day of Yahuwah is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be dark, and the sun and the stars shall withdraw their brightness, and Yahuwah shall roar from Mount Zion and give his voice from Jerusalem. And the Shamayim and the earth shall shake, and Yahuwah shall be the stronghold for the children of Israel."
Hallelujah.
And I'm going to leave it right there, sis.
That's plain to see.
You know, I like to go to Joel chapter 3 because it explains exactly what the Most High is going to do in the end times, whether with Israel and the Gentiles.
Yes. So, coming back also to, as I said, Gentiles, and we'll touch on that a little bit. So, you know, some people have a misinterpretation of the scriptures of the letters of Paul. And they have a tendency to say, you see here, they say that Gentiles will be saved and so on. But to my understanding, I know there are different types of Gentiles within the scripture. So again, you could correct me if I'm wrong. So I know they are born Gentiles. They are nations who are not of the commonwealth of Israel. And they are born Gentiles. And the Bible did mention these people. So we have different nations like the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, and all these people were Gentile nations. And then we had the Hellenized Gentiles, which are Israelites, who, when I spoke earlier about the 12 tribes of Israel, the kingdom was split. These Gentiles, the northern kingdom, who were not practicing Torah, and they went serving other gods other than the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they started acting and living as the Greeks. These were considered as Gentiles. Also, the Most High divorced them in the scripture. Are these also considered Gentiles?
Absolutely. The way I usually break it down so that people don't get confused is you have heathen Gentile, And then you have Israelite Gentiles, you know. And one of the ways you could spot him, you can tell an Israelite Gentile because he looks like an Israelite, only he behaves like a Greek. We see him today. They still exist.
Yep.
We see him today. We just don't call them, you know, Hellenized Gentiles. We call them Alphas and Q-Dogs and Thetas and Zetas and, you know, AKAs and Deltas. Those are the same things that they was doing back then, which got the Most High mad to the point where he divorced them. Because yes, they were no longer practicing circumcision of the foreskin, which was also a very, very big deal in Israel, because that was the covenant between Abraham and the Most High. So even if you had the blood going through your veins, if you were not circumcised in your foreskin as a grown man, you weren't considered an Israelite. Matter of fact, you were considered unclean like the heathen.
Correct. So even today we could see, as you so rightly said, for most of the Israelites who are asleep, and even those who are awakened to this truth, if you're not practicing Torah that we have between us, the Israelites and the Most High, and you are living as the, as today's, as we say, the Babylonians, today's Babylonians, you come like a Gentile because you're not living up to the ways of the Israelites. How are we supposed to live? So when you look at it, it's the same thing that is taking place right now.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so when it comes to these heathen Gentiles and the Israelite Gentiles who are not practicing Torah and living anyway, this is where I think a lot of people get mixed up and people try to put the two together as one. And this is the big mistake they're having. Because if the Bible mentions the different types of Gentiles, a lot of people group them as one and say that the Hamashiach came and died for everybody. They say that the Gentiles will be grafted in and so on, which they don't understand the history. This is the whole problem with Christianity. Christianity packaged our book, stole these heathens, stole our book, and they packaged it a certain way and sell it back to us, which was not the whole story. And most of it was propaganda and lies. And if we do understand, if we have to understand this, the New Testament, so-called New Testament, we have to understand the Old Testament. We have to understand why the Hamashiach died, and how we were sent into exile, and how we broke the covenants, and what were the covenants that we had between us and the Most High. Yeah. Once we understand these things, then we will understand why the Hamashiach had to come and die. This is where the salvation comes. As we were discussing before, and as you so rightly read the script, because we broke that covenant, we needed the salvation. Because of the covenant we broke with the Most High, and because of that, we needed salvation. The other nations don't need salvation because the covenant wasn't made with them. It was made with us. And because of that, we needed the salvation. Now, people have a tendency to say, well, like how we are starting Christianity, yeah, but he still died for all of us because the script talk about Gentiles. So let me flow that balloon a little bit. I'll come back to that. Now, if the script say that, let me flow that balloon. If salvation was for everybody, how come? You know, I always like to ask my questions, Yahneqotha, you know me.
If fact,
that was so, why did only one people went into slavery and suffer the consequences that lines up with Deuteronomy 28:68? Then if everybody's salvation was for everybody, then the whole world would have gone into this slavery and the curses would have fallen on the whole world. But why it was a particular group of people that fit the description of Deuteronomy 28? That alone said it. So that means this covenant was for a particular people with certain consequences, if we broke these consequences, which we did, and the consequences went into effect till this day. So salvation was just for these particular people, which is the biblical Israelites, who we know as the Negro people today. Some say African Americans, the Caribbean people and those who are scattered abroad. So we know some of the tribes are still in the motherland, and we know some of the tribes are scattered within the Americas, which is consists of North America, Central America, South America, and the Caribbean islands.
All correct. And then I would even pose another question. Well, if everybody's saved and can get into the kingdom that believes on the Messiah, then why is there 12 gates with the name of the 12 tribes of Israel? Why are there angels on either side of those gates to keep other people out of those gates if everybody can come in?
That is what they don't want to answer, and that is what they don't want to face. And the truth is the truth. And you know, we're gonna talk it plain on this podcast. We're gonna no say change. It like we mean it, and we're not gonna dance around the answer. Another thing they like to talk about, remember, flow that ball with the Gentiles. And another thing they like to attack us when it comes to saying that the Messiah died for everybody. They like to bring up Acts 10 with Cornelius. So they tend to say that, okay, if he didn't die for everybody, how come in Acts 10, Peter had a dream and he dreamt of different unclean animals that were forbidden to the Israelites. And a voice came down from heaven and told him to eat. He never eaten anything that is unclean. And the voice told, which is the Most High, said, do not say anything. What he blesses is clean. He should be able to eat it still. And we know the story that Peter came to his house and Peter baptized everybody in the house and so on. They're saying that Cornelius was a Gentile because he was from the Italian band. My question is this. When I read the script and he said he was praying, the angel came and told him he was a man of great prayer and he gave a lot of alms and so on. And the angel came to him. Now my question is this. If we know in those days it had a lot of paganism and a lot of false gods that these other nations pray to. If Cornelius was not an Israelite, how come the God of Israel answered him to tell him who, where to send him to, who to give him clarity if he was praying to a pagan God?
How would he even know which God to pray to if he was a heathen?
Exactly. And how come the God of the Israelite, the Elohim of the Israelite, answered his prayer if it was a pagan God he was praying to? He was an Israelite. And this is what people don't want to understand. And that's what they fail to understand when it comes to the scripture. He was an Israelite. Yeah. And this is where the Most High was reconciling the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom back to himself, where he was bringing us back as a people back to himself.
That's what the meaning of the dream was, because it's talking about how, you know, the Most High, you know, he had a dream about the swine. He said, I have never eaten anything that's unclean. And then when he woke up, Cornelius was there. But Cornelius was a centurion. He was a Roman citizen. He was Hellenized. They ate pork. So to an Israelite back in those days, somebody who ate pork was unclean, which is why in the dream, the Most High said, you don't call nothing that I have made unclean. As he was talking about Cornelius, because Cornelius was an Israelite and he was there to seek wisdom.
And this is what people fail to realize. And I know some Christians mix it up and say you could eat anything because of that dream. No, he's speaking about the state of the other tribes that they were, like you said, they were Hellenized. They didn't mix. The Southern Kingdom and the Northern Kingdom wasn't mixing. They never used to talk to one another. They never used to socialize with one another. Hamashiach came and bring us together. There was a division between us as tribes. Even with the Samaritan woman, as we look in the scripture with the Samaritans. When I was in Christianity, I never knew a Samaritan was an Israelite. Yahneqotha, I did not know these things. But after the Most High wake me up to this truth and who I am as an Israelite, I now understand what these things mean. Because when the Samaritan woman said, our forefathers worship at this well or drink by this well, it shows that she has history and she has lineage. And it's the same thing as the Jews in Jerusalem. So that means she's an Israelite. If she spoke about their forefathers, and if you realize, we always know that the Samaritan and the Jews, so-called Jews, never get along because of the division. that was between them.
Absolutely, because of they were the children of Mamzers, and they were mixed breeds. They were hybrids. They weren't actually full-blooded, because Northern Kingdom, well, you know, the Northern Kingdom did what the Northern Kingdom do. It was a whole lot. The sins of the Northern Kingdoms, Israel, if y'all are listening, you can find it in First and Second Chronicles, and also in First and Second Kings, where it talks about exactly what the Northern Kingdom did to be disavowed by the Most High. So much so that they got a literal bill of divorce. Then he had to tell the prophets, look, you know, I acted hastily, you know, so in the end time, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the wild olive branch and graft it back in. The wild olive branch would have been the northern tribe, because they were the ones acting like wildlings, you know, acting like they ain't had no home training, acting like the high Elohim was not our Elohim. So that's why they're the wild branch, you know, but they will be grafted back in. And that one stick, Ephraim and Judah, shall be one stick again as a rod in the hand of the Messiah.
Correct. But when I look at this whole scenario with some people saying that, John 3:16 saying that he died for everybody in the world, as taught us in Sunday school, red and yellow, black and white, Jesus loved all the little children of the world. And because of that indoctrination, as I said, as we know, they took our scriptures and they made a whole mess out of it. And I know there are some people believe that he died for everybody, and now they wake up to realize he did not. You still have an option to cleave. You still have an option to cleave. So even if you're not a blood Israelite, and the blood of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob does not run through your vein, you still have the option to cleave. What's the big thing? Once you follow the Torah, once you do what is right in the Most High's eyes, you have that option to cleave and, you know, follow the ways of the Most High. Mm-hmm. So it's not all lost.
Israel shall be blessed. Those that curse Israel shall be cursed.
Another thing what I have noticed, Yahneqotha, is that a lot of people who say they're cleaving, they still feel they're better than Israel. They still feel that they have the upper hand on us. Or you all were outcast so we could get in. And this is a wrong concept and a wrong ideology they have about us as a people and what happened between us and the Most High. It doesn't mean you are better than us. And most people need to get that out of their minds. If you're cleaving, just cleave. Don't feel you're better than the original branches. Don't feel you're better than the children of Israel whom God has blessed and who are the apple of his eye. And I mentioned this in the first episode of the podcast because I realized a lot of people who say the cleaving still has that mentality about being better than us. And I don't know if you have encountered anything like that before.
I have. I definitely. I mean, you see it because of the camps, you know, with that 12 tribes chart. And they got everybody fooled over here with that foolishness, thinking that these indigenous people or, you know, the Latino community, which has only been a community for as long as slavery had actually existed or colonization existed. They find themselves into these congregations, and then they want to say, oh, well, you know, I know I'm an Israelite, but you probably a Canaanite because Canaanites was black too. How do you, you know, they try to sow the seeds of doubt and all of that. So you gotta, in this walk, you have to be prayed up. You have to be learned up. Like, you have to have an unnatural thirst for the scripture, so that way you cannot be deceived by these man-made doctrines that are being thrown at our way as we get closer to redemption.
When it comes in the scriptures and they talk about being grafted in, like in Romans 11:17-24, could you shed any light on that, what that means for the Israelite? From my understanding, I think it means that the Northern Kingdom, as we say, who was Hellenized, these are the people we're going to see being grafted in back into the fold. What are your thoughts on that?
I believe so. That, you know, the Northern Kingdom, not to mention some of the brothers and sisters that have split off in the Southern Kingdom, you know, and went the way of the heathen and all of that. I believe that the Most High is going to rectify all things, and salvation and that grafting in will take place amongst the people of Israel and not the whole world, because it'll happen in front of the whole world, but it's not going to involve the whole world, if you know what I mean.
Yes. And I know people have a problem in understanding Paul's letters, and Paul's letters can be very difficult at times to understand. A lot of people have a lot of misconceptions when it comes to what he has written. And Paul's audience, as we could see and understand, so far what we have discussed is basically the Israelites. He have been addressing the Israelites. So we know that when Paul had his conversion and they were separated, he was separated to go to the uncircumcision. And Peter was separated to go to the circumcision. So Paul, I guess, was sent to those who were Hellenized Israelites.
Absolutely.
And another question is, if everyone was supposed to be saved, how come Paul didn't go to places like China and other nations that, you know, that we will say today, we have all these other different races and nations? It seems to me in the scripture, wherever Paul went, because he was assigned to the uncircumcision, and when he addressed the congregation, he mostly would say his fellow Israelite brethren. When he addressed the congregation, whoever he was sending the letters to. So right. It seems to me that areas that he went to was only areas where Hellenized Israelites lived. And he was given the map to go to tell these people, okay, our Messiah came, you all need to get your act together, come back home, start practicing the Torah. But he did not went out his way to go to other nations where Israelites were not living, basically.
Right. Wherever the dispersion took place, he went to those places, because you got to remember he was a Roman citizen. And the reason why he was sent to the uncircumcised was because nobody knew Torah better than he did. The only person on the earth in them days that knew the Torah better than Paul or Saul was the Hamashiach himself, Yeshua. He knew the scripture because he was the scripture. But he went to Paul because nobody knew the Torah better than Paul did, because Paul was the persecutor of the disciples. Remember, the Messiah used to always tell them, y'all need to learn the law. You need to learn Torah. You need to become masters of Torah. And they used to always take it lightly. And they did. They found out why the Messiah would always say that, because Paul was a master when it came to the Torah. He was a master. And he was also very well learned in the Talmud. And so when the Messiah came and converted Saul, Saul put away all of that he knew about the Talmud. He wouldn't teach the Talmud anymore. He began to teach the Torah to those Israelites who were Hellenized, because they no longer knew the Torah. So he would show up and teach them the Torah, the old ways of our ancestors. And then Peter would show up and then expound on what he just dropped by telling them about the Messiah and what he knew in the teachings of the Messiah. So they weren't just being converted by Paul, but Paul and Peter and the rest of them, it was like twofold. So you had the flesh with the spirit. And that's what the Old Testament and New Testament is. It's the flesh and the spirit all together.
Nicely
and when you
said.
Have the flesh and the spirit, you have the Messiah.
But Yahneqotha, while you're talking, I was thinking about this as well. Seeing that the Hamashiach came to reconcile the 12 tribes of Israel, which were scattered abroad, and bring us back as one kingdom, one nation, is that the reason why Paul got upset when Peter, one minute he eaten with the circumcision and then he didn't want to eat with the uncircumcision, and was causing that disparity, that separation again when they were trying to unite the tribes together when
exactly.
Peter did that. That's why he confronted him to his face, correct?
That is correct. That is the reason why Paul ripped Peter apart.
And this is the thing. yeah, this is the thing, is sometimes you try to correct people and sometimes you need to bring correction. And this is where Paul had was to bring the correction and set him straight.
Mm-hmm. And to set him straight, like, who are you to sit there and call these people unclean when you yourself are filled with sin? Embarrass them in front of everybody.
Yes.
And he did what the Messiah used to do to Peter. See, Peter kept a, for those of y'all that read the other version of the scriptures, Peter used to have a mouth on him, but he forgot that the Messiah used to get on him a lot about that. You know, he was real big on, oh, well, this, that, no, you need to chill. Matter of fact, Peter was called Satan twice by the Messiah.
Yes, correct.
So,
when I look at this, what is your take on all of this? Seeing that we are a blessed people in spite of our troubles and what we have faced as a people, what is your expectations? We know the Most High is waking us up, which is great. We are living in exciting times. We know the Most High has set the wheels in motion where he's waking up the 12 tribes of Israel scattered abroad, who those who of us who are asleep have now awoke to what is going on, to the truth of who we are as a people. And like I was saying in the first podcast, I didn't realize how big the Israelite community is. It's very huge. I know it's not limited to Facebook only, but it, you know, you have a tendency to think that it has so much people still asleep. Yes, we know a lot of us still asleep, but we have to refocus that a lot of us have already awakened. And the Most High is doing a great job. What are your expectations? What advice would you give to us as a people? What to look forward to?
I believe in this time, we should be paying attention to all of the signs and wonders that's been going on. You know, the earthquakes, the volcanoes, all of these, what they call natural disasters, are actually plagues from the Most High. And, you know, the 400-year prophecy said that the Most High was going to judge the nation that had us in captivity, and then we would get ready to leave, or we would leave with great substance. So my advice to Zion and all those that are listening within the sound of my voice, you need to take on the spirit of Yosef and begin to prepare yourself. However the Holy Spirit tells you to prepare, you need to not waste time. You need to get on that and do that. You know, there's scripture, and I believe it's in Isaiah, where it talks about, behold, I shall make Zion dwell in tents again. Well, if that's the case, then my brothers and sisters, it's too easy to go to the store and buy a tent. You know, I mean, we know that the words of Yah do not come back void. So if he said we were going to go and dwell in tents again, well, right now would seem about the best time to go to the store and be able to get yourself a nice tent. Begin to prepare yourself, you know, as if you're getting ready to go somewhere, you know, and you're taking all your camping equipment and all of the stuff that you need to be comfortable. Prepare yourselves. The Most High will stretch whatever it is that you have stored up, but you have to have something for him to stretch. And then outside of that, just keep the law, statutes, commandments to the very best of your abilities.
Hallelujah. I am so excited of what the Most High is doing amongst us as a people. And in closing, I'd like to, again, to reiterate what you're saying. We need to prepare ourselves, Israel. It's one thing knowing that you're an Israelite, but it does not stop there. To my listening audience, we need to put ourselves in place and remember the mistakes our ancestors has made, which has us in this position in the first place. Once we are awakened to the truth of who we are as a people, we need to study the script and get ourselves back in right standing with the Most High. As Brother Yahneqotha just said, we need to get back to the laws, statutes and commandments of the Most High, Yah. Keep his Sabbaths holy. And then we have to remember the Hamashiach who has died for our sins, reconciling us, the 12 tribes of Israel, back unto himself. We have to also acknowledge him as the Hamashiach. We need to get our house in order. We need to wake up our fellow Israelites and tell them who they are, so they could too enjoy what the Most High is doing in this end time amongst us as a people. We are a blessed people in spite of all what we have faced and the challenges we have faced as a people throughout slavery. And we know if we've studied the history, most of these nations has had enslaved us in the past. But the Most High is waking us up to our true identity. And He is doing a great work. And what He has started, He is able to complete it in our lives. May the Most High continue to be praised in each and every one of our lives as the children of Israel. And I want to thank Yahneqotha for coming on my podcast. Thank you so much for blessing us with your presence.
Anytime, sis, anytime. Just say the word, I'm here.
And we would like you to come back again because an hour is not enough. You have so much to share with us. And this has been another episode of Straight Talk, No Chaser. And I'd like to say blessings to the 12 tribes scattered abroad. Shalom.
Shalom.